Marriage is an eternal bond and it should be handled carefully. But unfortunately, there are many divorces, there are judicial separation, domestic violence, cruelty, no matter it is mental and physical. And that's why there is always a confusion between what exactly is the meaning of domestic violence, how it is related with cruelty, and what is the meaning of dowry death. All these things are necessary to understand in a very, very appropriate manner. Hello everyone, I'm Dr. Priya Sipaha, and in this video we are going to discuss section 498A in detail, its relation and its misuse in present scenario, and also what is the relation between section 498A and Domestic Violence Act 2005. So stay tuned. First of all, let's understand the background of section 498A of Indian Penal Code. Initially, when this particular Indian Penal Code was enacted, section 498A was not in existence because there was not any need of this particular section. This section is related to dowry and cruelty. Dowry is a gift which is given by the parents of bride at the time of marriage to the bridegroom and their family members. When it was started, it was only a form of a gift which is given at the time of marriage out of love and affection. But by the time it has been increased in a very rampant manner, and then it become more of curse than a gift. I have made a separate video on section 304B of Indian Penal Code, which is related to dowry death. 1980 till 1990, that was the time when India was flooded with the cases of dowry death. And it is really very sad that this particular thing is still happening in many areas and in many families in India, which has been resulted to section 498A, that is a cruelty by the husband and husband's relative for the demand of dowry. So first of all, let's understand what this particular section speaks about. According to section 498A of the Indian Penal Code, whoever being the husband or the relative of the husband of a woman subjects such woman to cruelty shall be punished with imprisonment for a term which may extend to 3 years and shall also be liable to fine. The offences cognizable, non-compoundable and non-bailable. So as far as ingredients of section 498A is there, the first thing which is important to understand is that there must be cruelty by husband or husband's relative on any female. Now that cruelty could be a mental cruelty and a physical cruelty. That particular cruelty must be due to the demand of dowry. To understand this particular thing, let's read explanation of section 498A of IPC. It says that cruelty means any willful conduct which is of such a nature as is likely to drive the woman to commit suicide or to cause grave injury or danger to life, limb or health, which is whether mental or physical of the woman, or harassment of the woman where such harassment is with a view to coercing her or any person related to her to meet any unlawful demand for any property or valuable security, or is on account of failure by her or any person related to her to meet such demand. Cruelty is of two types. The first one is physical cruelty and second is mental cruelty. Physical cruelty can be identified very evidently because it is appear in the body in a form of a hurt or a grievous hurt. But as far as mental cruelty is concerned, it is very, very difficult to identify and understand mental cruelty because there are certain things, there are certain feelings, there are certain repercussions of a particular act which can be dangerous, which can be very harmful, or which can be considered as a part of a cruelty for some person, but it is not at all possible that it could be cruel for any other person. But there are some very petty and very weird issues also which is termed as mental cruelty in these days, but in the eye of law, it is not considered as a issue or a mental cruelty, like going for a holiday in abroad, then purchasing a luxurious car, then purchasing a luxurious home, then going for a very luxurious holiday. These type of things are not considered as a mental cruelty if your husband cannot afford these particular things. So you have to be very cautious whenever you are accusing anyone under section 498A of I. Some of the form of mental cruelty which is acceptable by everyone is, one is demand of a boy child and forcefully getting aborted female feticide. Then if there is a demand of a dowry, then if they stop, if the husband or the relatives of the husband stop a female to meet their parents or relatives or friends, or do not allow her to do a job, or do not allow her to go to meet any person, or if they are taking all her money, or if they are taking all her salary and many other things. As far as dowry is concerned, it could be in any form. It could be in a form of a money, in a form of a property, in a form of a jewelry, in a form of automobiles, a type of any sort of privilege. A demand of dowry could be at the time of a marriage or after marriage also, as I said earlier, and it could be in any form. There was a case in which a demand of 10,000 rupees was made by husband to the father of a wife and for the security deposit of some important work, and that was also attracted section 498A of IPC because it was considered that it is a undue demand which was made after marriage by husband. So if there is an abetment of suicide by husband or husband's relatives on women on the demand or due to the demand of dowry, then it will attract section 113A of the Indian Evidence Act. So section 113A of Indian Evidence Act is presumption as to abetment of suicide by a married woman. When the question is whether the commission of suicide by a woman had been abetted by her husband or any relative of her husband, and it is shown that she had committed suicide within a period of 7 years from the date of her marriage, and that her marriage or such relative of her husband had subjected her to cruelty, the court may presume, having regard to all the other circumstances of the case, that such suicide had been abetted by her husband or by such relative of her husband. So basically section 113 is something which is very important, in which there must be an evidence of such type of abetment, that the husband and their relative had abetted due because of cruelty, no matter mental and physical, to women, that she has committed suicide. That is very important. Now about the nature of this particular offense. As far as section 498A is concerned, as I have already said, that it is an cognizable offense. Now cognizable means that this is considered as a serious offense for which a police officer can arrest a woman's husband and their relative without a warrant. And secondly, it is a non-bailable offense also. And thirdly, it is non-compoundable offense also. Although in non-compoundable offense, there cannot be any settlement between the parties once the FIR has been lodged. But in family cases or these type of offenses, there are certain cases where the settlement has been done between the two parties, because these are the cases which is related to marriage and it is considered as a very personal matter, and everybody wants that there must be some compromise between the husband and the wife. Nobody wants that their marriage should be break. Now the next question is, who can file the complaint? Now the complaint can be filed by a woman, a aggrieved woman who is a victim of any cruelty. Secondly, by her parents. Thirdly, by the close relatives. Fourthly, by any other relative. And also, this particular provision is provided for the second wife also. Even the second wife can file a complaint. Now the next question is whether any woman can file a complaint against Section 498A of IPC if she is in a live-in relationship. So the answer is no, because it is an essential ingredient of Section 498A that a female must be legally married. And if a female is living in a live-in relationship, she is not supposed, or that complaint will not be entertained by the police and the court. Next thing is related to the time limit of this particular offense. Now, any victim of this particular offense can file a complaint within the 3 years of her marriage or within the 3 years of the cruelty, and the proof must be given of that particular cruelty also. There are many allegations and misuse of Section 498A of IPC. Many person has said that the women are using this particular section as a weapon rather than a shield. It is also termed as legal terrorism. But no matter, there are n number of allegations related to this particular section. Still, this section is very important for the protection of women. But there are certain changes because of some cases which is highlighted by many other person, and there are many cases where actually this particular section has been misused. So let's discuss about the changes which has been amended in this particular section, especially related to the arrest of a husband and the relative of the husband and direction to the police at the time of arrest. There are two leading cases where the directions of the Supreme Court has been given at the time of the arrest also, and how this particular case should be handled. So the first case is Arnesh Kumar versus State of Bihar. In this particular case, the direction where the first one is police officer not to automatically arrest the accused when a case under Section 498A IPC is registered. They should satisfy themselves about the necessity of arrest under parameters flowing from Section 41 CRPC. Now the next thing is police officer shall fill the checklist and furnish the reasons and material necessitate the arrest. Third thing is the magistrate will authorize detention only after recording its satisfaction on the report furnished by the police officers. Fourth, if the police officer failed to comply with the directions, they will be liable for departmental action as well as punishment for contempt of court. Fifth is failure of the judicial magistrate to comply with the directions will render him liable for departmental action by the appropriate High Court. The next case is Rajesh Sharma versus State of UP. Here also certain direction has been given. The first one is complainant under Section 498A and other connected offences may be investigated only by the designated investigating officers of the area. Secondly, if a settlement is reached between the parties, it is open to them to approach the High Court under Section 482 seeking quashing of proceeding or any other order. Third, if a bail application is filled with at least 1 day's notice to the public prosecutor or complainant, the same may be decided as far as possible on the same day. Recovery of disputed dowry items may not by itself be a ground for denial of bail if maintenance or other right of wife, minor children can otherwise be protected. Then, in respect of persons ordinarily resident out of India, impounding of passports or issuance of red corner notice should not be a routine. Then these direction will not apply in case of tangible physical injury or death. So that's all for today. I hope you liked the video, and if you like it, do not forget to hit the like button and subscribe my channel and press the bell icon also to get a quick notification of my videos. Please do comment on comment box also that whether you like this video or not, and what are the other things which you want, what are the other topics for which you want me to make a video. So see you soon. Take care. Bye bye.